Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Today we are going to discuss a disease of the eyelid which is known as ptosis, which comes under the heading of malposition of the eyelids. The other two entities which are included in the diseases of the eyelids are inflammation of the eyelids and tumors of the eyelid. What is ptosis? Ptosis is an abnormally low position of the upper lid. It is also known as drooping of the eyelid, which may be classified as congenital or acquired. Now, when a patient comes to you with a ptosis, there are certain pattern which you have to follow to reach the diagnosis and ultimately the treatment. For that purpose, first of all, you have to evaluate the patient and make sure that either it's a pseudo ptosis or a true ptosis. Pseudo means it gives an impression of a ptosis, but actually it is not a ptosis. We have to classify, because the treatment depends upon the type of the ptosis. Broadly, we can classify the ptosis into four types: neurogenic, which can be due to third nerve palsy, as the levator palpebrae spiralis muscle is supplied by the third nerve. It can occur in Ohnet syndrome, Marcus-Gonzow winking syndrome, and myasthenia gravis as well. Then comes the myogenic ptosis. As the name suggests, it is related to the muscles. And the diseases which affect the muscles include chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia or any muscular dystrophies. Then comes the epineurotic ptosis. Senile ptosis is the leading cause of epineurotic ptosis, and it can also occur after surgery or trauma to the eyelid. Then comes the mechanical ptosis. It is due to some lid mass tumor or secondary to any scarring with a history of previous trauma. In this slide, all of these things are already explained. The neurogenic consists of third nerve palsy, third nerve misdirection, Ohnet syndrome, and Marcus-Gonzow winking syndrome. Marcus-Gonzow winking syndrome is an uncommon cause of congenital ptosis. What is the pathology? It is due to syncytic innervation of levator and pterygoid muscle by the fifth nerve. So it occurs due to the abnormal junction or abnormal communication between the third and the fifth cranial nerve, which is the oculomotor and the trigeminal nerve. So when this happens, movement of jaw leads to the eye to wink. This is known as Marcus-Gonzow winking syndrome. Then comes the myogenic, the diseases related to the muscles, which include myasthenia gravis, myotonic dystrophy, ocular myopathies. Simple congenital ptosis is also included in myogenic ptosis. And then there is a syndrome which is known as blepharophimosis syndrome, which we will discuss ahead. Epineurotic, as I previously told you, it is due to age and it can be secondary to surgery or trauma. And then there is a mechanical ptosis, which is due to any ocular tumor or scarring. How do you evaluate a patient? First of all, history. The age of onset of ptosis and the duration will usually distinguish congenital from the acquired ptosis. If the history is ambiguous, means that if history is not giving you any hint, you have to ask the patient for the old photographs, which may show any change in severity with time. It is also important to inquire about symptoms of possible underlying systemic disease, such as diplopia. Diplopia means double vision. A variability of ptosis means you have to ask the patient whether is there any difference of this ptosis in the morning compared to the evening, the severity, either it is more in the evening or in the morning. That may lead to the diagnosis of myasthenia gravis, because in cases of myasthenia gravis, the fatigability increases as the day goes on. So if the patient tells you that the diplopia and the ptosis increases with the time during the day, that means it is a case of myasthenia gravis. Now, what is pseudoptosis? Pseudoptosis is a condition in which eye looks like having a ptosis, but actually there is a problem with the other eye, or you can say there is some other cause. For example, if you see in this picture, there is a lack of lid support in the right eye, and it gives you feeling that it is a case of ptosis, but actually it's not. Now, in this picture, if you look clearly, you can mislead to the diagnosis of left ptosis, but the left upper lid is its normal position. The reason of being disparity in the two eyelids is that the right upper lid is slightly upper than its normal position, and that usually occurs in the thyroid eye disease. It is known as lid retraction. Then there is a condition which is known as ipsilateral hypotropia, means the whole of the eyeball is slightly downward as compared to the other eye. If you look at this picture, the right eye is at its normal position, but the left eye is slightly below the other eye. So when the eyeball moves downward, ultimately the upper eyelid will also move with it, and it will give you a feeling of pseudoptosis. Now there is a condition which is known as broptosis. It is secondary to the excessive eyebrow skin. And then dermatoclasis. With age, sometimes the eyelid skin usually lax, and it gives you appearance of a pseudoptosis. And actually, it is not a ptosis. Now come the evaluation. In evaluation, the first sign which you have to look is for marginal reflex distance. Now, what is marginal reflex distance? It is also known as MRD. It is the distance between the upper eyelid margin and the light reflex. Now, where will the light reflex come from? It will come from the torch when you place it in front of the patient, and you will observe a central reflection from the cornea. Now you have to measure the distance from that reflection to the upper lid. Usually it is 4 millimeter. If it is 3 millimeter, it will be graded as mild ptosis. 2 will be labeled as moderate, and if it is less than 1, it is known as severe ptosis. Remember that it can also go into negative as well, minus as well. It can be minus 1 millimeter as well, provided the lid margin is 1 millimeter below that reflex. So how will you check it? By elevating the lid manually. Then there is another sign which is known as levator function. Levator function basically depicts the amount of movement of the lid which is being done by the levator papillary spirals. Usually we ask the patient to look down, and we press the superior orbital margin with the thumb, just to make sure that the orbitalis muscles does not help the levator palpebrae superioris muscle. So we will only check the function of levator palpebrae superioris. Now when we ask the patient to look down, we place the thumb right over the orbital margin and ask the patient to look up and measure the distance covered. If it is 15 mm or more, it is normal. More than 12, it's considered as good. Between 5 to 11 mm, it is considered as fair of levator function. And if the eyelid moves less than 4 mm, it will be classified as poor levator function. It is an important factor, because ultimately the treatment of the ptosis will depend upon this phenomena and one another phenomena. Vertical fissure height, it is also known as palpable fissure height. What is palpable fissure? It is the opening between the upper and lower lid. So basically, distance between the upper and lower lid margin is known as PFH. Palpable fissure height. Normally it is 8 to 10 millimeter, but in cases of ptosis it will be reduced depending upon the severity of the ptosis. Always remember, you have to compare the measurements in both eyes. Now there are two other signs. Number one, upper lid crease. It is the distance between the lid margin and the lid crease in the down gaze. Normally it is 10 millimeter in females and 8 millimeter in males. The absence of the upper lid crease signifies, or it is a pure sign of congenital ptosis. In cases where the upper lid crease is high, it suggests an aponeurotic ptosis, or secondary to age or any previous history of surgery or trauma. Then there is a pre-tarsal show. It is the distance between the lash line and the skin fold in the primary position of gaze. Now, I have told you that one sign which is required for the treatment, or which is important for the treatment of ptosis, is levator function. The other phenomena is Bell's phenomena. What is this Bell's phenomena and how we will check it? In this, we will explain it to the patient that we will try to open the eye and ask the patient to close the eye. What will happen is that the eyeball will roll upward. If the patient is able to roll the eyeball upward and you cannot see the cornea, that means the Bell's phenomena is good. And if you can see the cornea, that means the Bell's phenomena is not that good, and that is a poor prognostic factor and can be a risk for post-operative corneal exposure, and ultimately it can lead to painful blind eye. There are some scenarios, there are some conditions, clinical conditions that we go through in our clinics, and one of them is third nerve palsy. Third nerve is a nerve which supplies intra and extraocular structure as well. It supplies the pupil, it supplies the extraocular muscles, and it also supplies the levator papulopapillary sphereus muscle. So if there is a defect in the third nerve, you will see all these structures affected. So in a typical case of left third nerve palsy, there will be a ptosis of the affected side. There will be a paralytic squint. The eye will be in down and out position, and pupil may be dilated. Then there is a condition which is known as third nerve misdirection. It is a rare unilateral condition. Usually occur after the third nerve palsy as an aberrant regeneration. What happened actually is that after the aberrant regeneration, when the patient moves his eyes, usually you will see bizarre movements of the upper lid as well. It is due to aberrant regeneration of the third nerve. Then comes the Ohno syndrome. It is a disease related to sympathetic chain and caused by oculosympathetic palsy. Usually is unilateral, present with mild ptosis and meiosis. Sometimes the pupil dilations are normal. There is a slight elevation of the lower lid. Iris hypochromia. Hypochromia means there is a decreased pigmentation. Then there is anhidrosis if lesion is below the superior cervical ganglion. Anhidrosis means that on that side there will be decreased sweating. What is Marcus Dunn-Jaw-Wicking syndrome? As I have explained to you before, it is mainly abnormal communication between the third nerve and the fifth nerve, and whenever the patient moves his pterygoid muscles while eating, while chewing, the ptotic lid will move. The ptosis will improve as well. This is known as Marcus Dunn-Jaw-Wicking syndrome. Then there are some myopathies. In ocular myasthenia, the patient may present with ptosis or diplopia. As I told you before, in cases of myasthenia gravis, the patient will present with the history of worsening of the symptoms as the day goes on. Diplopia is usually intermittent and usually vertical. Myotonic dystrophy. If a patient with myotonic dystrophy comes to you, ptosis will be one of the prominent features, but the diagnosis is mainly based upon some other features, like there will be facial weakness and expressionless face, and muscle wasting will be present. Sometimes involvement of tongue and pharyngeal muscles may also be present. Usually this achondroplasia is uncommon. These are the cases which, when comes to you, should be referred to a physician to rule out any systemic abnormality. Now comes this simple congenital ptosis. Simple congenital ptosis is defined as abnormally low position of the eyelid with respect to the globe, occurring at the birth or soon after the birth. It can be classified into primary or secondary. Primary can be due to levator maldevelopment, and secondary can be due to neurogenic, myogenic, aponeurotic, and mechanical. Blepharomosis syndrome is a rare cause of congenital ptosis with the autosomal dominant inheritance, and is defined as a narrowing of horizontal palpebral aperture. Usually in ptosis, the vertical palpebral aperture is shortened, but in this case, the horizontal distance is also decreased. Ptosis is present with very poor levator function, and the upper lid crease is also absent. Telecanthus may be present. What is telecanthus? It is the distance between the two canthae. Now, if you look at this picture, the distance between the two middle canthae is very large as compared to the normal person. There is epicanthus inversus. What is epicanthus inversus? Usually, it is the skin fold arising from the medial lower lid and ascending to the upper eyelid. Normally, it is the other way around. Then comes the aponeurotic ptosis, can be caused by trauma or surgery or blepharoclasis. Characterized by high upper lid crease, the levator function is good. In severe cases, the upper lid crease is absent, similar to that of congenital ptosis, and the sulci are deep. And you can see the loss of orbital fat. Then there is mechanical ptosis, secondary to dermatoclasis. There is a skin, excessive skin over the eyelid, and it can be to tumors, which sometimes give a specific S-shaped ptosis. Now, in this picture, this is most probably a tumor related to the lacrimal gland, which lies in the near proximity. Severe lid edema can also lead to ptosis, and sometimes the orbital lesions can also present with ptosis or dystopia. In this picture, you can also see the eyeball is also deviated slightly, which is known as dystopia. Now, how will you manage? As I told you previously, there are two main on which the treatment depends. Factors on which the treatment depend. Number one, you have to find out the cause of the ptosis, the severity of the ptosis, and levator function. Types of surgery include the number one, conjunctival molar resection. This is indicated for the ptosis with good levator function, and usually some part of the tarsus and the lower border of molar muscle is excised. Then there is levator resection. It is indicated for a patient having a levator function of at least 5 mm. Usually the muscle is exposed and being excised according to the severity and reattached to the epignosis. Then comes the frontalis bro suspension. As the name suggests, suspension means we give a support to the lid. It is usually done in cases with the levator function less than 4 mm and in syndromes like Marcus Gunn jaw winking syndrome. Because the levator function is very low, we have to give a support which can be done with the help of a silicone band, or sometimes the fascia lata from the lateral compartment of the lower limb can be used for this purpose. But while doing this procedure, one should make sure that the Bell's phenomena of the patient is good, because if the Bell's phenomena is not good, the patient will ultimately have exposed cornea, lead to painful blind eye, secondary to exposure keratopathy.